guys. Welcome back to the Political Reading Corner, where we talk about the politics of American literature. Today, we are going to discuss how Ella Cara Deloria's novel, Waterlily, depicts how the Dakota Sioux mother their children in ways that are beneficial to the Sioux children, despite communal mothering having a different appearance from white women's individualist motherhood structure. This depiction is crucial to white readers' understanding of Sioux and Indigenous culture and is part of Deloria's efforts to educate white audiences on Indigenous culture in order to stop the discriminatory practices being instilled against Indigenous groups, specifically boarding schools. So let's get into it. Ella Cara Deloria was born in 1889 on the White Swan Yankton Sioux Reservation. She worked as an anthropologist and social activist. Deloria was born shortly after the U.S. federal government began sending Indigenous children to boarding schools, and that is a political movement that needs to be understood before we can begin looking at Deloria's writing and life. On this channel, I discuss how women authors use motherhood themes in their literature to promote a political goal or cause. The women I read call for an end to slavery, the Chinese Exclusion Act, Japanese internment camps, and discriminatory practices against Indigenous communities. But in researching Deloria's work to end discriminatory practices against Indigenous communities, such as boarding schools, I found that white women were actually also using motherhood rhetoric in support of the discriminatory practices. I highly recommend reading Margaret D. Jacobs' full article about maternal colonialism, and of course, I'll link it down below along with all the other sources from this video, but I'll also summarize its importance to Deloria's Waterlily here quick. Jacobs discusses how white women elevated white motherhood to a sacred state and used it as the basis for political action. White women saw it as their maternalistic duty to rescue Indigenous children from what the white women considered a savage background and to raise them instead in a civilized environment. And these efforts conveniently improved the white women's marginalized status by providing them with a position of power and responsibility. However, Jacobs notes that while these women promoted their own motherhood as justification for political action and social status, they simultaneously represented Indigenous women as unfit mothers. By viewing Indigenous women as subservient to men, sexually immoral, and unable to keep a proper domestic space to raise children in, white women justified their actions by arguing that they were extending their own motherhood outside of their home and into society by rescuing oppressed children. These are clearly simplistic stereotypes, as Jacobs puts it, and wrongly justify the removal of children from their homes and cultures. Indigenous authors and ethnographers like Deloria worked hard to dispel these stereotypes, but because they can only respond to these stereotypes after they are made and are forced to work in a society full of systemic discrimination against them, it proved to be difficult. So these white women worked to remove Indigenous children from their communities and place them in boarding schools. As scholar Andrea Smith explains, boarding schools were used to culturally assimilate Indigenous children to an Anglo-American lifestyle. This is where the historical saying, "kill the Indian in order to save the man," comes from. Smith explains that the point was to separate children from their parents, inculcate Christianity and white cultural values into them, and encourage or force them to assimilate into the dominant society. However, Smith notes that racism prevented full assimilation, so the boarding schools were designed to assimilate the children into the bottom of the socioeconomic ladder of the larger society. This meant that boys were trained to be manual laborers, while girls were taught domestic work like laundry and cooking. While these programs were obviously extremely discriminatory and damaging on a racial level, more issues come to light when you consider that the schools were financially motivated. Smith explains that the children were given inadequate food and medical care and were overcrowded in these schools. As a result, children routinely died in mass numbers of starvation and disease. In addition, children were often forced to do grueling work in order to raise money for the schools and salaries for the teachers and administrators. While the children were being forced to work to pay their teachers, the teachers mistreated them with sexual, physical, and emotional violence prevalent in the boarding school's histories. Noting the horrors that occurred in these schools, Smith labels them as human rights violations and explains the basis for demanding reparations. The effects of these schools continue today, with Smith noting that the historical trauma of these schools has resulted in increased physical, sexual, and emotional violence in Native communities, unemployment and underemployment in Native communities, increased suicide rates, increased substance abuse, loss of language and loss of religious and cultural traditions, increased depression and post-traumatic stress disorder, and increased child abuse in Native communities. Deloria does not explicitly mention the boarding schools in her novel, which is set in pre-colonial times. However, they are a motivating factor for writing the book. The schools were a form of forcing cultural assimilation from Indigenous communities, but really, the schools were part of a larger, complex, multifaceted process of destroying Indigenous culture. Another example of this purposeful destruction was the banning of Indigenous languages or practices, such as the sun dance. The sun dance is an important spiritual ritual in the Sioux community, as explained in Waterlily, but it was banned by the U.S. government in 1904. Deloria's novel fights against this cultural assimilation by providing examples to white audiences about the purposes of Indigenous practices, values, and roles within the community, specifically motherhood for the purpose of this video. So let's talk about Waterlily in light of all this historical and political information. Waterlily is a novel, but it's very ethnographic in nature. Ethnographies explain a culture, and Deloria has taken this educational information that would be in an ethnography and put it into novel form to make it more accessible for white readers. By sharing the cultural information of the Dakota Sioux in this accessible format, scholar Janet Finn notes that Deloria creates common ground such that the cultural logic of the Dakota comes to make common sense, even to those whose cultural experience is framed around a differing logic. As Finn implies, white women do not understand Dakota Sioux culture and are thus able to see it as wrong and create harmful political processes to erase their culture. But if Deloria can get them to understand why they do the things that they do, if she can get them to see Indigenous practices as holding the same level of common sense as Anglo-American practices, then the Indigenous culture will be protected. So how does she do this in relation to motherhood? While the white women view motherhood as individualistic, with a proper domestic space being of utmost importance, Deloria shows the communal mothering style of the Dakota Sioux, and most importantly, demonstrates that the children are still healthy and successful. The change in mothering style does not harm the children, as the white women claim as justification for removing the children from their tribes. Deloria describes how the main character, Waterlily, and the other mothers share mothering duties. When the mothers need to attend a funeral, they send their children to stay with Waterlily, who soon finds herself with 8 small children on her hands. It is important to note here that Waterlily is not simply babysitting the children. She is acting as their mother. When one of the other mothers drops her child off to be with Waterlily, the mother tells her daughter to mind your mother, referring here to Waterlily as the girl's mother, despite Waterlily not being of biological relation to the girl. While this communal mothering may be different from white women's mothering, Deloria is careful to emphasize that it still prioritizes the children and creates a good society. The narrator describes that, just as white women believe, Waterlily's mother tells her that she must remember that your children are more important than you. Always the new life comes first. Additionally, the narrator emphasizes the benefits of these kinship relations when she says, "This is what auxiliary parents were for, to step in and take over in place of one's own parents in their absence, to reach out and extricate on and surround one with home-like tenderness." Finally, a cousin of Waterlily's husband describes how woman's nature is driven by their single desire to soothe children. By having both the narrator and a character describe the natural inclination of Indigenous women to prioritize and care for children, Deloria rejects white women's claims that Indigenous women are incapable mothers who must have their children removed from them. I think Deloria's efforts are courageous and critical to the preservation of Indigenous culture. Unfortunately, her contemporaries did not agree. As Bain describes, Deloria wanted to provide a counter-narrative to the social problem discourse surrounding Indigenous cultures, and publishing this novel would have been one way of reaching white audiences and encouraging an end to discriminatory practices such as boarding schools. However, while she tried to get the novel published in 1948, it was rejected. It was finally published posthumously in 1988, which is still important, but that 40-year difference really says a lot. It demonstrates publishers' racism, that they either wouldn't publish an Indigenous author or they didn't think people would want to read about Indigenous culture, all of which ties directly into the colonialist state of mind that Deloria was actively trying to fight against. So there you go, folks. An analysis of how motherhood is used by Ella Cara Deloria as one form of depicting Indigenous culture as different, but productive and beneficial, as well as the counter-argument made by white women that Deloria fought against, that Indigenous women are unfit to be mothers and should have their children raised by white women instead. As always, my sources will be linked below. I just want to shout out Margaret Jacobs' article one more time. It's fantastic and you should all go read it. It's not super long and it has pictures. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Go and spread peace, friends.